My screen?
Yes.
Okay. So if you've got any questions about real estate at all, this should sort of bridge the gaps and clear it up a little bit. There's a bigger scope of understanding when it comes to real estate, whether you're thinking about a traditional. So Erica's thinking more property management. Leslie, are you thinking more on the lines of a support position or a sales position in real estate?
A sales position.
Okay. Traditional residential resale?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Very good. Very good. So this is always really helpful for me to understand, you know, where you guys are at and what your goals are for this conversation. It'll help tailor the conversation a little bit better. But one of the things we all agree on is that real estate's a massive industry and it is super lucrative, fast-paced, exciting, flexible, challenging, fun. However, what's great about it is that it is suitable for skills and personalities of all kinds. So no matter what you bring to the table, no matter what your experience or your skill set is, that will lend itself so well to real estate because people end up doing business with people, not firms. All right, so today we'll talk about what an agent is, what an agent does, the day in the life of an agent, this being a solo agent versus being a team member, whether you're managing properties or whether you're focused on the residential market, that you have to understand the brokerage model because both of you are going to be hanging your license with a broker until you're able to obtain your brokerage license. You've got to know what those new agent programs look like no matter where you're going, no matter what your focus is. And then questions to ask when interviewing. At some point in time, you're going to be hanging your license with a broker. It's going to be really important for you to understand who that broker really is because brokers are not created all as equal. Just like salespeople aren't all created as equal. And then we'll get into the pre-licensing packages and how to get started, okay? All right, ladies. Okay, thank you, Leslie. This is gonna be interactive. So yeah. Chime in where you guys can. So, Miss Leslie, can you do me a favor? Can you just read that slide for me?
Okay, what does a real estate agent do? Consult, educate, and assist people in the purchase of property. This is often the single largest financial transaction. Oh, let's cut off right here. A person will make in their life. Job description, lead generate.
Okay, so I kept it really simple. We already know that this is the largest financial transaction a human being is going to make in their lifetime. We get that. What's the point of this? The point of this is to drive home one very important point, which is, you guys, you're stepping into a space where you're really responsible for consulting, educating, and assisting, not selling, not getting people to make decisions that they don't really want to make, not getting them to, not convincing them that purchasing this particular property is in their best interest. If we are to consult, if we are to educate and assist, then that means that we have to step into this role as business owners with a growth mindset, meaning the more we learn, the more we're able to guide and direct. And all we can do is give our clients the information they need to make informed decisions. That's all we're here to do. If you go with A, here are the pros and the cons. If you go with B, here are the pros and the cons. As a consultant, it is my job to stay up to speed and up to par. And what I don't know today, I will learn today to earn what it is I want to earn tomorrow. And then job description, I keep it really simple. It's lead generate. You know, those are sales terms. But at the end of the day, you guys, we're talking to you as business owners, self-managed leaders. Your job description, whether you own a Subway franchise, a Starbucks franchise, a retail clothing outlet, a hair salon, a taco shop on the beach, your job is to always develop business because that's how you stay alive. So pick it. You're either a W-2 employee creating wealth for somebody else, doing what? Sales for somebody else, developing business for somebody else, or you're doing it for yourself. Very simply put. All right. So I often, you know, stop here and take a moment and go, okay, ladies, how much money do you want to make in your first year of business? So today's no different. So, okay, ladies, You've decided to get your real estate license. Put your brain here. In 2024, you've decided to get your real estate license and go active. Tell me, how much money will you make, will want to make in your first year of real estate that says, this was a successful year, I'm going to keep moving forward? How much money do you guys want to make in real estate?
More than what I'm making now.
Great. Put modesty in your back pocket, Erica. Modesty in the back pocket. How much money do you want to make?
Hey. So I would say for me, given that I'm focusing slightly in the same industry, but a different avenue of earnings, I would say in a given year, to make it easy, the more the merrier. If I could hit that 1 million plus, that'd be a great advantage, given that Kern County is what it is today. If I can even hit over, like I said, if I can hit over what I'm making now, 200K to start off, then that would be a successful year for me. And of course, with the advantages of understanding how I can, what the potential and growth is, you got to start somewhere, right? Of course, in real estate, it's not always going to be the first big bang, but if you get lucky enough, it will be. But understanding the market is a key point of it all. And I think with the amount of investments we're looking at doing this year, I can see us having a good potential with me still maintaining my current job, but eventually slowly triggering off of where I'm at today to go solo into this industry to venture out and
So
to
in
be
your
my
first year, in your first year of real estate, you would be happy at 200,000.
if I can make it out there. Yeah, that would make me comfortable.
Miss Leslie, how about you?
I would say 50K.
How much?
50?
50,000.
Yes.
And that's great. By the way, the number that Leslie defines as success in her first year of real estate and Erica, two different success goals. Two different success goals. So we're not comparing one to the other because our life circumstances are so different. And that's what Leslie wants. She wants $50,000 a year. Why? I used to have working moms with three and four kids. Actually, they weren't working moms. They were stay-at-home moms with kids. That's a full-time job doing real estate on the side, but we're very clear with their goals. I had one mom who's a top producing agent today who was a working mom back in the day, and she only wanted to make $40,000 a year. Because $40,000 a year, every year she had a different goal. One year it was to add a pool in the backyard. Another year it was, kids and sports. Another year it was family vacations. And then the kids all grew up and she decided to go full-fledged, full-time, and became a top producer to this day. So your goals are your goals. But did that feel comfortable naming that number, or did it feel uncomfortable naming that number?
A little uncomfortable.
Miss Erica, comfortable or uncomfortable with that number?
A little bit of both. A little bit of both, because I am reaching a bit higher, right? Given the expectations, I'm barely learning the industry. But if it's something that can be met, then of course that's my own mindset and setting out that if it's out there, it's out there and it's out for me to grab, right?
By the way, perfectly normal. Perfectly normal to be uncomfortable with naming that number. A lot of us, male and female, have a hard time connecting with worth, self-worth, worth, or and connecting that to a financial dollar. So when the reason why I get you to go there is because once you've said it, you can forget it and it will happen. Because now you've said it, it's in the ethers. It's possible. My rookie of the year made $254,000 her first year. She was a single mom with two kids from Sweden. Didn't have a single friend locally that she could rely on, but she went and built up that business and did a great job. Did a great job. So anything is possible. Anything is possible. Sky's the limit when it comes to real estate. All right, here's what your day looks like. Now, whether you're doing this part-time or you're transitioning, this is what your day or days in real estate will look like. And it's always going to include personal investment time, which is how we power ourselves up, how we invest in ourselves, from meditation to fitness to reading to podcasting to whatever that is that fuels us up in the morning. That's our time. Then we move right into lead generation time, which is a very time blocked space of time that allows us to focus on developing those relationships and lead generating, finding those referral opportunities and expanding on conversations and building relationships. Lunch, got to fill up the tank so that we can keep it moving. We've got client follow-up, return calls, emails, and text messaging from 1 to 1:30, because if we did a really great job between 9 and 12, we've got a lot of follow-up, and everybody knows gold is in the follow-up. If we did a great job, we're also now preparing for our appointments. We're creating contracts, buyer presentations, seller presentations, research material, comparative market analysis. We're getting all of our work done for those appointments that we set up that we're going to execute against between 2 and 5. We're going to go do those appointments. We're going to show properties. And then when we're done, we're going to return more calls, more emails, and possibly, if we're really lucky, we scheduled 1 or 2 more appointments in the evening. We're doing that for the first 18 months of our career. It looks like this: 1 day a week, 2 days a week, 3 days a week, 6 days a week, sometimes 7 days a week, all depending on what our goals are. If we want to get to 200,000, there's a very specific model that's going to get us to that 200,000. There's a very specific day that we are going to have to time block and manage that'll drive the activities that will drive the goal. Right now, if you guys are working, you have an 8 to 5 time block where you're creating wealth for somebody else who's already created the job descriptions that they know are going to drive the results that they want. So once you get your real estate license, you are going to be looking for brokers, you guys. Brokers are looking for one thing. They're looking for one thing that looks like somebody who is motivated, driven, has perseverance, learning-based, self-starter, disciplined, has a little bit of personality, somewhat social, gets that we're in a people business, and committed to transitioning or full-time. Now, the one thing they're looking for is a combination of these traits that they know will net a return on their investment. They're going to invest in you and your growth. They want to know that if they're investing in you full-time, you're investing in them. They don't want to hear that this is a side hustle. They don't want to hear that this is part-time. They want to hear that you're transitioning full-time, however long that takes, and you're committed to real estate and a career in real estate. Okay. And by the way, part-time, full-time, you know, who's to define what that is, right? Full-time to somebody could be 30 hours a week, and part-time could be 40 hours a week or 10 hours a week. So look, moving and transitioning into real estate full-time is the goal, and anywhere from 20 to 60 hours a week is what it's going to take to achieve those goals. All right, so here's what we're looking for. When you get that license, you guys need to be aware that as you're talking to real estate people now or real estate brokers now, please understand that you understand when you're comparing apples to apples and apples to oranges, because not all brokerages are created equal, because the different brokerages have different business models. And so when you're asking one broker what their compensation plan is, and they give you a 50-50 split, and another broker that says, oh, we only charge $500 a transaction, stop, pause, listen, and ask more questions. Because it doesn't mean that the person that's only charging $500 per transaction is better than the person charging you a 50-50 per commission split. There are more questions to be asked. I will give you a list of 32 questions that you can sort of percolate on and review and evaluate to just trigger more thought. But different brokerage models will provide different services. So just know that, and the services can be very micro. So you've got a dependent model, 100% company, an independent broker, a discount broker, and an employer-based broker. 5 different primary brokerage models. The dependent model are where the associates are dependent on the company and its brand. The brand is everything. The brand is very valuable, especially to new agents, because those new agents haven't quite developed the skill sets yet. And oh, by the way, the consumer doesn't know you're any different. They don't know that you're two minutes in the business versus somebody who's 20 years in the business if you both have a business card that says Coldwell Banker. It's brand recognition, and it's instant credibility, and it's helpful. So you'll typically, as a new agent, find yourself gravitating towards a dependent model. You'll also find gravitating towards 100% company is also equally as valuable. Okay. You just have to know the difference. Now, 100% company are where the associates have an interdependent relationship with the company, but a mutual interest in success. This is where associates and brokers work as teams, achieving financial goals. In 100% company, this is an environment really supportive of big, large teams. In a dependent model, the dependent model isn't really doesn't really have the compensation model that supports big, large teams. So this model supports the independent solo agent very well because it's the most profitable for that model. 100% companies are designed differently. The associates don't assume all the financial or legal management responsibilities. They've got a great brand. However, because they pay less, they have, it's more of a smorgasbord or a buffet of offering of services, where the dependent model offers a very specific brand of service. So let me just break that down. In a dependent model, these are companies like Pacific Sotheby's, Compass, Century 21, Coldwell Banker, Berkshire Hathaway, okay? These are what we call dependent models, big brands, been around forever, paved the path for most real estate brokerages, and they have very well-known brands and very canned, structured training systems and programs, okay? Nothing creative, all very predictable, dependable marketing systems and training technologies. For this, you're going to pay from your commission in two ways. You're going to pay what we call company dollar. So if you were to earn a $10,000 commission fee, you would be paying a percentage to company dollar that keeps the local brokerage lights on, doors open, staff paid to support you. You'll also be paying a franchise fee. That franchise fee is for the honor and privilege of being associated with that brand, and that goes to the executive or international team at corporate, if you will. Okay. So you're going to pay a franchise fee and a company dollar fee, and then the rest will be yours. Potentially, you're going to have to pay a mentor fee too. So there's a couple of ways that that commission check is going to break down, all well worth its value, all well, as long as it's worth its value to you. 100% companies are where these are companies that charge you a specific company dollar, maybe a franchise, maybe not a franchise fee, but they'll only charge you a set amount every year. And once you meet that set amount, they'll put you on 100% commission for all the transactions that you close thereafter, and that will reset every year, okay? The dependent model will charge you on every transaction in perpetuity. As long as you're hanging your license with them, they'll charge you for every transaction. Your only negotiating power here is production and performance. The more production you do, the more performance you do, the more negotiating power you have to reduce your commission splits. With the 100% company, they're just going to say, look, pay us $26,000 a year, 20 will go to company dollar, 6 will go to royalty. The rest will be yours at 100% commission for any transaction that you close after you pay us this fixed amount every year. Okay. In this model, you'll potentially pay a monthly fee and you can potentially pay a royalty, all depending on the brand. These examples of these companies would be a Keller Williams, an EXP Realty, an LPT Realty, a Side, and a Real Brokerage. These are all names of different brokerages that operate as what we call 100% companies. Again, once you pay them that fixed amount every year, boom, every transaction you close thereafter will be at 100% commission until it resets every year. The independent broker is an interesting model. This independent broker is usually a top producing agent that used to work over here or over here in the dependent model or 100% company. They've decided to go open up their own brokerage and hire agents. This model is usually an independent broker, so it's not a franchise fee. So typically you'll pay a percentage, usually a 10 to 20% commission to the broker, unless you're on a new agent program, and that can adjust up. But you won't pay them a franchise fee because they're not franchised. They're independent. So there's a little bit of savings here. One of the things that I often recommend is that you do a great deal of discerning and interviewing with the independent brokers to make sure that their new agent programs meet your standards and what you're going to need to launch your real estate career. Again, the first 18 months of your career are going to be very critical to your success. The NAR statistics, the National Association of Realtors statistics, indicate that 85% of the new licensees are out of business in the first 18 months of their career. Who you associate in the first 18 months of your career is paramount. Discount brokers will charge you a flat fee. You're not asking for a lot. They're not going to deliver a lot. You're not asking for support. You're not asking for training. Therefore, you essentially have a landlord-tenant relationship with this particular broker. You're just going to pay them a flat rate fee. You've got your insurance covered. You've got your broker covered. You're on your own. You know how you want to run your business. You don't need anybody telling you what to do or how to do it. You're either coming in for a soft landing. You're definitely not going to this type of a broker to build your business unless you already know how to build your business. Associates assume more financial and legal management responsibilities because the broker's not making much off of you, so they're not going to be offering much in the way of support. An employer broker is a lot along the lines of what Erica is looking to do or doing, and that's a company like a property management company, a new home development company. These companies require you to be licensed. However, because they've got built-in business, they're basically paying you bonuses based on performance, and you're not really having to hunt. You're essentially the gatherer, the farmer. Okay. Again, property management companies, you're doing licensee activities. So they'll pay you a W-2. They'll pay you a little bit more if you're licensed. New home development companies, they already own the inventory. So you're not out having to find a listing. You're actually selling the inventory they have. So they'll pay you a bonus based on performance. Other companies, Redfin is an employee-based online-only real estate company. That's an example of employer broker. And who else? Oh, timeshare. If you guys move into timeshare, you got 6 months to get licensed. Got to be licensed because those are licensee activities. But that's another opportunity in real estate. Requires a license, okay? The latest and greatest to come into the market is what we call the mega agent team. The mega agent team is usually housed at either the 100% company, an independent broker, a discount broker. And this is where the main agent, the team leader, has mastered the art of lead generation so well and growth that they literally need agents to help them service all the leads they're able to generate. And it's usually not only a local area, but an expanded area of coverage. Mega agents typically associate with a larger brokerage as a clearinghouse because they don't want the brokerage responsibilities. However, they're really good at the big brand. So if you want to be a part of a team, this would be an option for you. Any questions?
No, no questions.
Helpful.
Very. Okay, a lot of information for sure.
Okay, great. Good, good, good. So that's what this is designed to do, is to help you with your decision-making process, right? So now, do I want to be a solo agent? Do I want to be a part of a team? A solo agent is what we call the pathfinder. This is the person who wants independence, flexibility, the ability to make quick decisions, full control over all business strategies, and have a direct relationship with their clients, a direct relationship that they own. Solo agent cons. Because you're limited in capacity, your limited capacity to scale is directly correlated to your profitability. So the more profitable, the more resources you're able to build in, the more systems and processes you're able to build in, the better you'll do. However, you're always juggling that, right? Because you're a one-man marching band. So that could potentially be the con to being a solo agent. It's the figuring out how to balance adding resources tied to growth and profitability. Challenges in this process as you expand and scale can lead to potential burnout because you're obviously, as a solo artist, handling so many responsibilities that, you know, unless you build out proper systems and processes, it can lead to burnout. Now, a team, what's cool about a team is that there is strength in numbers. The pros, you're able to leverage the team resources, meaning marketing's built in, transaction coordinating's built in, marketing coordinators are built in, support, mentoring, coaching, all of that is built in, and you end up sharing the workloads and responsibilities across departments that have already been developed, right? So great pros to being a part of a team. You have instant access to mentors, coaching, diverse skill sets, expertise. And then it allows you to be singularly focused on one thing, which is business, developing relationships, developing business, which is the sales end of it, not the operations end of it. The con, well, you have to master the art of communication with this particular model, because there is a shared commission and income distribution, and it could lead to potential conflicts if you're not really good with communication. In other words, your goals are the team goals. You're not a solo artist. Whatever decision you make, whatever actions you take, involve somebody other than you. So you've got decision making in the solo agent versus the team. You've got the solo gets to make the call and work autonomously and is responsible for all decision making. As a team, you get to work in a collaborative decision making process where you share the wins and losses across the team. You've got to balance input, individual input with collective goals. Now you've got the client interaction, solo versus team. You've got solo agent whose personal relationships are owned by the solo agent, where when you're a part of a team, if you build a relationship with that team, it belongs to the team owner. So if you ever leave that team, you're starting over again, building new relationships. The team's ability to provide comprehensive services is definitely a pro, and impact on client satisfaction and referrals is definitely a pro for both, but also for the solo agent, because the solo agent can manage personal satisfaction because they don't have to manage across multiple departments. So you've got marketing and branding. You get to stand out in the market with a solo agent's personal brand. So as a solo agent, you get to determine how you look and feel and come across as a solo agent, where the team already has marketing strategies and a presence that already exists. So you're stepping into somebody else's brand. Then you've got financial considerations. You, as a solo agent, you're responsible for counting the expenses and counting the costs. Well, with a team, you're leveraging expenses. So instead of you buying a one user site at a premium rate, as a part of a team, you're buying a one user site at a leveraged rate because the team has probably 100 licenses across the board. Now you're comparing income potential between being a solo agent or the stability being a part of a team. You've got to evaluate those two. Okay, what's more important to you? Potential, stability. Last but not least, making the choice, finding your path is helpful when you've got a mentor, a coach, a sounding board. You've got to work that through with a trusted advisor. Factors when considering, you know, the solo versus team is self-assessment, you know, your individual preference and strength versus, you know, whether or not you think you can be successful as a solo career agent or a team collaborative partner, right? So making the choice, you just have to weigh the pros and the cons to one or the other. Does that make sense? Was that helpful? Was I confusing? I felt like I was confusing.
No.
Information for sure.
It's a lot to weigh, right? It's a lot to weigh. I'm going to rewrite that. I don't like the way that rolls, but I think you get it. Now we're choosing a real estate company. So we know the real estate brokerages. We know the different brands. We know the compensation models. We know the difference between being a solo agent. We get the gist on the positives of for being a part of a team. Don't confuse that when you guys start interviewing with brokers. When a broker says, come be a part of my team, they can also mean come be a part of my team as a solo agent, as opposed to come be a part of my team as a team member. All right. So let's not confuse you where that's concerned. But we're looking for a company, a real estate brokerage that has training, coaching. They have team models. They have individual models. They have marketing, technology, wealth building, culture. Erica, go ahead and read that quote for me.
Training and coaching is developed by studying and modeling the behaviors of most successful leaders. That is very true. And top agents are continually learning from each other and improving on ideas, training, and constantly improving. So that actually I was taught in where I'm at today. Leaders, good leaders, individuals that have potential can learn off of good leaders if given the opportunity. So I do believe in your guys' model there.
Yeah. And by the way, peer-to-peer growth as well. So we have to be growth-minded. Not only are we learning from those who have traveled before us, but we are learning from those that our colleagues, our peers that have traveled on different paths that we can learn from. So just as long as you know that entering and embarking on this real estate journey means that the one constant is change and learning, then this is your jam. This is going to be your jam. Now, in starting your own career, whatever it is, property management, traditional real estate, residential real estate, here's the thing. People do business with people. Here are the stats that prove where you should be focused on your business building tactics when embarking on this career once you're licensed. So 40% of the buyers and 41% of the sellers use the referral method to find an agent. 67% of the recent sellers used a referral, a neighbor, a friend, a relative, or somebody they worked with in the past. Now that number jumped to 75% for homeowners ages 22 to 40. All this tells you is that the referral business is a business model that you should invest in when launching your career and that you should be nurturing as you build your career. It is a solid staple business strategy in this business. By the way, any business, hair salon, property management, commercial, bulk, whatever business is tied to being successful through working with others, referral business is the most powerful way to build your business. Now, 9 in 10 of those buyers and 87% of the sellers would use their agent again and again or recommend their agent to others. That's consistent across all generations, you guys. All this means is that when we say our reputations are everything and our clients want to serve us, they want to support us, we just have to keep that in mind when building out a marketing plan, a business model that continues to serve us and our clients because they want to support us. All they need to do is remember who we are. I'm literally masterminding with agents that have been in the business for 20 plus years, telling me that their pain points are the fact that they don't have a CRM. They're literally working from an Excel spreadsheet. It blows my mind. And yet you can't argue with the success because 20 years they've been doing it. However, in my professional experience, they could be doing so much more and working less, working smarter and not hard by adopting some technology and incorporating that into their business plan. Again, building a marketing plan and a business plan that supports the statistics is key to your success. Now, this is interesting. 77% of the buyers and 77% of the sellers contacted one agent before selecting one to assist with the sale of the home. Come on, you guys. Does this blow you away that more consumers are not cross-interviewing agents? Talk to me. 77% of the buyers and sellers only contacted one person. They're not cross-interviewing.
They're not doing their research on all the agents.
They're literally going, Erica, I met you at an open house. Will you help me find a house?
Yeah. You know, that's quite surprising when it comes down to experience. Sorry about my little one. But I know when I was purchasing, because, I mean, a lot of it to the whole people do business with people, you have to understand where that experience does come into play. A lot of the time when it comes down to the whole 77%, that's quite interesting for me, because I know I went through 4 agents to purchase one home, maybe because the market has changed and now it's just so cutthroat. And to really pinpoint, you know, it could take personality would be the reason why they went to you. Hey, I did see you at a marketing event And you know what? Something about you, I want you to be able to help me out. I think me and you can connect somehow, and connecting with those individuals, because that personality piece is going to be the most important, especially in this industry of selling.
So let's go back to that. Leslie, Leslie, I'm going to come to you next, but let's go back to that, Erica. So that's interesting. You went through four agents. Mm-hmm. You properly interviewed four agents before you found the fourth one, or you went through four agents before you found the one that you loved?
I went through.
Interesting. And were any of the, out of the four, how many were actually referred to you?
One.
Okay, one. But yeah. You were willing to literally work with all four of them until they sort of fired themselves.
Pretty much. And the last one.
That's the 77% we're talking about. You're the perfect example of why that number is so interesting.
Mm-hmm.
Because you were willing to work with the first one and the first one got themselves fired. You were willing to work with the second one and they got themselves fired. Third and fourth. But here's the thing. This is us. So if 40% of our business will come from our referrals, but the other 70% will just come from meeting the client where the client needs to be met, all we have to do is show up on the runway of opportunity and or the highway of opportunity. We have people mm-hmm. that want to work with us. However, are we prepared when we meet the consumer where the consumer needs to be met? Or are we working from our bunkers? Or are we trying to find business from our home office? Or are we out doing open houses? Are we meeting clients in line at Costco? Are we doing those networking events? Are we doing those yard sales? Are we strategically and intentionally and purposefully building our business by making sure that we are on that highway of opportunity where the consumers are looking to buy and sell? Leslie, what do you think?
I find it very interesting.
Right? Yes. So Erica had, she's like, it's got the perfect example here because the consumer doesn't want to go through four people. They literally are just like, hey, you, me, let's do this. I liked you. You're here working. I can see that you're at the open house. I can see that you're in the neighborhood showing homes. I want to work with you because I know that you're working. And then you've got 1%. 1% of the people will find you from direct mail, walking into an office, newspaper, yellow pages, home book advertising, dropped a calendar off at your front door, 1% return. We don't want you to play in this area when it comes to building your business. We want you focused right here and building a business model that supports these statistics. And if you can do that, is this still a journey you're willing to embark on? Now, here are the new agent programs you're going to be looking for. And here's how you'll be holding your brokerage to a deliverable of training that will help you get up and running in your business. Got to know what your big why is. Leslie, you got to know why you want to do real estate. What is it? Not because I want to go show homes, not because I want to go, you know, because I like people. It's because why? It's because I want to build a life that I want to build, that I want to live. And I need something to fund it the way that I want to live it. Right? So it's a much bigger purpose. And then we break it down. And what do we want my goals to be this year? And what are they this month? And what are they this week? And what are they today? That will correlate and drive to the bigger objective. So you need training in your database, knowing your database is your business, not working from a spreadsheet, working from a CRM. Know your scripts, your dialogues, your objection handlers, how to work those open houses. We are not door openers. We're not babysitters. Prospecting, using social media, using the phone, using the door-to-door techniques, using what comes in our wheelhouse and using our superpower with those different modes of lead generating. How to work with buyers, how to work with sellers, how to show homes. There's a proper protocol for showing homes, making offers, receiving offers, negotiating the contract, working with sellers, knowing the difference between a pre-listing and a listing presentation. Again, how to use a CMA both with, with current clients as well as with prospects, and then how to market your listings from A to Z, open to close contracts. When you're in escrow, you're managing somewhere in the neighborhood of 14 different relationships. What does that look like? How do we do it? And then accountability, having a mentor and a coach that holds us accountable to reproducing the strategies and the tactics that led to results. This is your new agent training program. This will help you launch your business and your career. We're looking for technology, marketing with a broker that's going to offer us marketing flyers that already exist. We just need to put in the property information, print and go. We need a CRM that's included in our marketing fees, on-demand learning. So if I can't make it to training, I need to be able to catch up with what it is that I need to know today for my customers who are going to ask me those questions tomorrow. Websites, landing pages, either property sites, websites for our clients to search for properties and homes, and mobile apps, everything branded to us. These are the technologies and the resources that we need built in from the broker of choice. We're looking for culture, collaborative culture. We want to walk into a brokerage that is team oriented, where everybody shares and everybody's interested in the success of the broker, of the new agent. And they're willing to share with the new agent. So you want that to be a collaborative working environment. Remember, we're going into real estate, not just for the purposes of getting a commission, but also for building a great wealth portfolio. We want to buy and hold. We want to buy and flip. We want to buy and sell. And maybe it's timeshare. Maybe it's short-term rentals. Maybe it's long-term rentals. But there's more to real estate than just a commission check. Okay, and we're looking for business opportunities that come in both passive income and active income streams. Passive and active income streams. So here are some example, interview questions for you guys to just understand what will trigger more thought and conversation, will at least help you through the interviewing process with the broker. First of all, it's a two-way interview. I want you guys to know that. You are interviewing them, they are interviewing you. You ultimately have the decision as to where you go. You're going to ask about their mentoring programs. You're going to ask about the compensation plans, and you're going to ask if it's in writing, because you can't hold them to a deliverable if it's not in writing. Do I get to interview my mentor, or will you assign one to me? Can I shadow my mentor in the field? How long is the training program, and do I have to take it all at once? Do I get to go back to classes as many times as I want without any cost? And is there a charge for my new agent training? What are your production standards? And do I have to maintain a certain level of production? Do you have revenue growth or profit sharing programs for me? So if I refer other agents to the brokerage, do I get to share in either revenue or in profitability of the brokerage? And after my new agent training program, what's the next level system you have in place for me that'll allow me to succeed beyond my new agent level? How do I scale and grow with you, the broker? How are we doing, ladies?
Doing good.
Are we filling in gaps?
Yes.
Questions we didn't even know existed, right? But yeah. Thought provoking ideas and understanding of what, listen, it's out there, that all of this is out there. You just have to find what aligns with you. Find where it is and find who aligns with you from a value perspective to a training perspective to a business model perspective, and just know what you're getting into. So don't think you're going to get all this value if you're going to go to a discount broker. It's not going to happen. Okay. And don't expect the most aggressive commission splits if you want all this value your first year in business, because there's a lot of growth and a lot of learning. But guess what? Just because you're assigned a mentor, if they're not working for you, there is nothing stopping you from making a course correction somewhere. You're not stuck. You're never stuck. You always are in a position of power and negotiating power and change. Okay, so if we're good, here's how we get started. Ready? This is going to answer the question, what do I do? Which way do I go? And what works for me? So the state of California wants you to have 135 hours of DRE college approved credit. You probably see that all over the net. All that means is that our courses meet those requirements. So enough said. You don't have to spend 135 hours online in class. The course material itself already meets that requirement if you complete your chapter quizzes and your final exams with a 60% or better. Your chapter quizzes and final exams are the 60% or better. All of our testing is open book. You have to pass the state exam with a 70% or better. Our packages include real estate principles, practice, and law. With any of our courses, you can attend as many times as you want. We have an unlimited attendance policy. Our sponsor ID number, which is our course provider number, is 0655. We are licensed by the state of California to license you on these courses to qualify you to sit for the state exam. Okay. Our in-person classes are online, our online instructor-led classes and our in-person classes are not required courses. The only thing that is required is that you read your textbooks and complete your online work as instructed. So that starts us off with two programs, okay? The Fast Track program. This is the online only program with no instructor. Self-paced, independent study, all your textbooks, chapter quizzes, and final exams are online. No videos, no instructors, nobody interfering with your reading, your study process. It's one dimensional. You can get done as quickly as 54 days. You can take as long as 12 months. The state of California will regulate how quickly we move in the first 54 days. They want you to study 18 days on the first course before we unlock the first exam, 18 days on the second course before we unlock the second exam, 18 days on the third course before we unlock the third exam, 18 times 3 is 54 days. That's how you can get done as quickly as 54 days, but not a day sooner. Okay. If you go beyond the 12-month period, the system will wipe out any work that you have completed unless you've obtained a certificate, and it will ask you to re-enroll in those incomplete courses for another 12 months. We will help you with the DRE application processing. The Fast Track Lite includes the three courses only. The Fast Track program includes this extra course, which is an 8-hour online or in-person one-day prep course, which includes 1,100 state practice questions to prepare you for the state exam. It includes a coaching session that teaches you specific strategies and tactics for preparing for the state exam. We offer a 3-month payment plan on the Fast Track program, not on the Lite. If you want physical textbooks, they're additional for $75, okay? So you've got Fast Track Lite, no instructor, no crash course, no practice questions. You've got the Fast Track program, no instructor. It does include the one-day prep course, which is the crash course. It's a summary of everything you've already learned, and you're going to take it right before you take your state exam, okay? Group study is a 12-week program. It meets once a week, 2 hours weekly, for a live online instructor-led syllabus related to the course content. It comes with digital student manuals, physical textbooks, digital textbooks. It includes the one-day prep course with the practice questions, a student manual for the prep course, downloadable textbooks. This is also available to you on a payment plan. We will help you with the coaching as well when you can complete all three of your courses. And then we will help you with your application processing as well. Okay. All right. The one-day prep course, in the event that you decide to take the Fast Track Lite, you won't have the prep course. You will have to order the prep course at a later time. If you decide to go with our school, it's $249, and it includes the study plan meetup group, 6-hour online live course, a recorded copy of our online course, practice questions, and a student manual, and you can pay for it separately. However, you ladies, if you get the package program, it's all included. All right. Boot camp doesn't apply to you. So in closing, what you need to understand is that the study plan meetup group and the group study comes with all of our programs. When you have completed all three of your courses, we roll you into the study plan meetup group. That teaches you, like I said, how to develop a plan to prepare for the state exam while you're waiting for the DRE to process your application and while you're waiting for your exam date. We take advantage of that time. We don't let your foot off the pedal while you're waiting for the state to process your application. And incorporated in that time We've included a group study buddy hour, which meets Saturday mornings from 8 a.m. to however long you can study. And this is where students just like you who have completed all three of their courses come together Saturday mornings and they practice their multiple choice practice exam questions together, and they develop flashcards and they develop notes on all of their practice questions, zeroing in on keywords and key concepts. And for joining me today, you guys get discount codes. So discount code 75 off applies if you're paying in full. If you guys want to take advantage of the payment plan, you're just going to add PP to any one of these discount codes. For you guys, you've got two options. You either have the fast track option or the group study option. Fast track or group study. Group study comes with a live instructor-led program. We teach Wednesday mornings from 9 to 11, Thursday evenings from 5:30 to 7:30. Okay? Boot camp doesn't apply to you because we're not up and, well, we've gone live in so many locations. We're not doing boot camp as often as we did before. When you join one of our brokers, they'll reimburse you for the full cost of the course from your first closing. Okay? Up to $599. Questions?
So, I've been interested in the group
plan. Okay.
But is there one located here around? I've seen that you guys have one in Dublin, or?
We used to. We don't. So for you up in Livermore, the only offering that we have for you, Leslie, is a Zoom class. So those Zoom classes are available to you Wednesday mornings, 9 to 11, or Thursday evenings, 5:30 to 7:30. So you can go twice a week if you want. You can go once a week. Really, you only need to go once a week because it's the same material. And we teach on a continuous loop. So we teach every 12 weeks, four times a year. You can go to our classes as many times as you want, even while you're waiting for the DRE to process your application. We record all the sessions. If you miss a session, you can catch up on the recorded session.
Okay.
Okay. So recorded video sessions, live Zoom classes. They're small classes too, by the way. So they're great for learning. And it's a two-way exchange. It's not a webinar. It's like this. It's what we're experiencing right now. You're going to experience with the instructor. You get the physical books, the digital books. You get a set of 12 student manuals for your study. I mean, there's nobody that packs as much value as we do in our program. And then you have us all the way until we are onboarding you with a real estate brokerage.